His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together. I am delighted and absolutely honored to stand before you this afternoon, the Episcopal Church Women, and I have so many things I want to cover before I even get to my speech, so let me get started. First, I have to thank your coordinator, the president of the Episcopal Church Women, Beth Petty. Let's give her a round of applause. Because Beth, you've been talking for months now. It's been, what, 5 or 6 months at least? And we have worked together trying to figure out what we're going to do for today and figure out how we're going to put our crowns on and our feathers and everything else. And so we are we have become friends, and it has been a great honor to work with her. So I want to say thank you for the invitation. The next thing is I need to introduce to you some people who are very, very important to me. And I would love it if members of Trinity would stand. I have a few sisters with me today who, they go with me whenever I go someplace. My friends, my sisters, who are, that's my crew right here. They're always with me, so I thank them for being here today. I also want to make sure that, we just, the little girls, I don't know where they went. Was that a liturgical dance group from this church? They were so wonderful. I wanted to give them another round of applause. They were beautiful. And it's such a, it's a beautiful church. And actually, it reminds me of my grandmother's church in Hampton, or Newport News, Virginia. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that. And so I want to say thank you to the St. Stephen's family for this beautiful place for me to even stand in this pulpit. And finally, I need to introduce to you two women who mean the world to me. One who birthed me into this world and one who has just birthed me through my life. And I want to introduce my mother, Deborah Brown, from Orlando, Florida. Because they flew into town to go see Hamilton. So, you know, we had to just take advantage of the moment, and I'm just delighted that they are here, and they both are women who I can't even start to quantify what they mean to me. They have been everything to me as I have modeled myself after them. Because of the women that they are. So I'm grateful. I'm grateful, and I love them very, very dearly. So to my sisters in Christ, in service and in life, good morning to you. It gives me such great pleasure to be here with you today. And some of you may be wondering, how is this woman from the United Church of Christ, how does she infiltrate and get over here with us Episcopal Church women? Well, I have a story to tell you, because I am an unofficial, official Episcopalian. I am probably, what, fourth generation Episcopalian. I just happened to marry a Baptist minister who turned United Church of Christ on us, and so I have so many memories, and really, this looks like St. Augustine's Episcopal Church, where all of my memories can be traced back to as a little girl sitting on the pews with my grandma in the back of the church, drawing while I was sitting on the kneeler, and she, when I was drawing on the seat of the chair on my little paper, and being with her and just remembering just the smells and the bells of the Episcopal Church, which means so much to me. I am a pastor's wife and have been a pastor's wife for 20 years, but I've been Otis's wife for almost 23 years. Do you all realize that 23 years have passed that quickly? And so it is always wonderful to be able to just be in the house of the Lord with women. And you all look fantastic today with your crowns on. And it's just wonderful to look out to see you today. So I am just very happy to be here. And it is good to be in the house of the Lord. And it's good to be with Episcopalians. So let me just keep on moving on. So as you may be starting to understand a little bit about who I am, I'm a person comes from a very varied background. I'm also extremely curious, and I love to ask questions. As a young child, I can recall a question that I raised quite often, and that question was to usually my grandmother or my mother, and I would say, tell me about the olden days, and tell me about when you were a little girl. I was fascinated about how their lives compared to mine. I wanted to know what they did for fun. What songs did they sing? What types of clothes did they wear? And what was life like for them? I wanted to see myself in the woman that I admired most as a child. Today, I still find that same sense of curiosity, raising questions and challenging what exists before me. I do it all the time. And my mother-in-law always says to me, Monica, you just keep on thinking through things because you always get to the right answer somehow. And because I ask so many questions, I think that's what happens. I still have to process and question things in order to gain a better understanding. And so today I have some questions to raise to you, my sisters. And the main question is, who will be the women who are strong enough, courageous enough, secure enough, and bold enough to not only ask the hard questions, but to be the change that they yearn to see in this world? I oftentimes wonder, where are the women? Where are the women who are willing to use their voices and their lives to live in the type of faith that not only moves mountains, but also changes outcomes? Where are the sisters who've already taken on this world to ask the question, what is it that makes me come alive? What is it that God has placed in you to accomplish and to achieve for God and for God's people? Today I raise the question not only to satisfy my own sense of curiosity, but also to pose a challenge, because in my heart of hearts, I already know the answer, my sisters. Because when I look out at you, I see that you are the answer. I am the answer, and today we are the women who are called to be the answer. There's a woman that I have fallen in love with, and her name is Dr. Donna Markova. Has anyone heard of Dr. Donna Markova? Donna Markova is a noted educator and a writer who has written a poem that literally stopped me in my tracks last summer. I rediscovered a book that had sat upon my shelf for many years. I bought two of them, actually. They were on sale in a bookstore. I bought two, I gave one away, and I kept one for myself, but I never opened it for years. Well, last summer, I opened up this book, and as the saying goes, when the student is ready, the teacher will appear. Dr. Donna Markova was my teacher. She was a teacher that my soul and my spirit needed in that particular season of my life. God has been very, very generous to me when it comes to teachers and women who have provided mentorship and nurturing in my life. Two of them are seated here with you, and actually some more of them are in this room. I can often say, I oftentimes tell people that I collect women because I love being in the presence of women. I've always liked women who were much older than myself too. And so I would just, from my piano teachers to just women who I just would cling to, and I was always just seeking that camaraderie and that sisterhood, but it was also that sense of wisdom that I gained from them. And so in Dr. Markova's book, it's called Wide Open, she issues the challenge of living a life of passion and purpose. And while this book is the type of book that you treasure and you read it and you reread it multiple times over your life, there's a poem inside of this book that is what really stopped me in my tracks. The poem is called, I Will Not Die an Unlived Life. And it resonated and became the teacher that I needed in my life to take me to another level of understanding. Here's the point. I will not die an unlived life. I will not live in fear of falling or catching fire. I choose to inhabit my days, to allow my living to open me, to make me less afraid, more accessible, to loosen my heart until it becomes a wing, a torch, a promise. I choose to risk my significance, to live so that which came to me as seed goes on to the next as blossom, and that which came to me as blossom goes on as fruit. The poem catches my breath and touches my heart every time I hear it, because inherent in its intent is a challenge to live with passion and purpose, and most importantly, to live courageously on behalf of oneself and others. I wonder if I'm that type of woman. In my mind, I hear another question being asked. Where are the women who are willing to plant the seeds and then to have the patience and the stamina to ensure that the seeds issue forth tender sprouts that turn to blossom and eventually bear fruit? It takes women to nurture the dreams of others. And yet another question springs forth. Are we willing to ask ourselves, what is it that truly makes us come alive? I'm convinced that the question begs to be answered, especially now. Especially now in this world where there seems to be so much turmoil. Now is the time to struggle with the questions, my sisters, because I tell you, there is a generation of younger women awaiting your answers, and they are hungry for your answers. They are curious to know if they matter enough for us to garner our attention, to take up some of our space and some of our time. Their delivery and their style may be very, very different than what makes us comfortable and what we're used to. And the way that they interact with us may make us uncomfortable, but their desire to hear from the elders remains. And I don't know when this magical moment happens, but somehow we all find ourselves a member of the Grown Women's Club at some point in our lives. It's a club we all join, but none of us seek out its membership. One day we just suddenly look up and find ourselves members when a young man in the grocery store who's bagging our groceries says, ma'am, can I help you, with this? Or the young lady in the department store comes over to you and says, could you look at this outfit? I need an older woman's opinion about this. It's also the moment when the sales lady compliments your haircut and tells you she likes to see a mature elderly woman wearing a sophisticated short hairstyle. We're all eventually a member of this unnamed organization, and it's actually kind of a nice organization because there are no meetings and there are no national conferences to attend. You don't have to pay any dues to be a part, but there is a requirement. And that requirement is that we give back to the younger generations of women who will follow. We are called to show them the way. There's a quote I love by Howard Thurman, and it says, "Do not be silent. There is no limit to the power that may be released through you." Unlike ever before, we're experiencing change and upheaval on unprecedented levels. There seems to be a sense of unrest, discomfort, and constant questioning of systems, structures, traditions, and norms. I know that as a mother of a 13-year-old daughter, you may pray for me every night, and a 16-year-old young man, keep the prayers flowing, please, that there are questions that young people are raising that are difficult and provocative. Sometimes I can't even believe the conversations that I have with my children, who feel very free to ask me anything they want, which is both good and bad, because I spend a lot of time with my jaw on the floor because they have the audacity to ask, but it's a good thing because they're exposed to so much. They ask me difficult and scary questions about their safety, sex, terrorism, violence, politics, and their futures. And oftentimes, I don't even know if what I say makes any sense, but I keep on trying to answer the questions. My children at young, tender ages of 13 and 16 have lost friends to gun violence, suicide, and accidents at 13 and 16. They wonder, as young African Americans, if their lives matter. They are concerned about even getting home safely. They question whether they are invulnerable, whether they are vulnerable in their schools, and even if their schools will remain open. They question their futures, college, jobs, financial security. The internet, a part of their daily routine. This is how kids go to school now. You know that they do everything online. The internet is both a powerful resource, and it's a great source of information, but it's also a very scary place, and it requires constant monitoring for their safety. Children are required to process so much more information than ever before, and during developmental times, they should be filled with running and jumping and make-believing. They are sitting in front of screens, inundated with a barrage of unreal reality TV and unhealthy messages damaging their spirits and of these impressionable young people. They need us more than ever. And it truly surprises me how open and receptive so many young people are when we just pay them attention and offer unconditional love. That's the caveat. You have to offer unconditional love as well. And I have seen this quite a bit as a pastor's wife. Young women who come to church, you know, 20s, 30s, they have so many questions, and so many of them don't have anyone to ask because they just don't have it. Their communities don't have people that can answer the questions that they desperately need to have answered. And I want to bring this up because it's so close to my heart right now. Last night we buried at Trinity. We had a memorial homegoing service for a woman who was this type of woman. And I want to bring up, I want to call her name because she is a perfect person who lived on principle, and she lived passionately, and she was a minister, and she was just an awesome woman, Reverend Linda Mushri Dodd.
Yes, yes.
Yes, and what my husband said at her funeral last night was that she understood that everyone needs someone who has their back. She understood that you need to have someone in your life who's willing to tell you the truth even when it hurts.
Yes.
And someone who is an example of faithfulness and who loves the Lord and glorifies God. And that was Reverend Linda Mushri Dodd, who now is in the heavenly realm. And I think she's up there bossing people around. And she was a very powerful woman. And so I know that she's standing in the gap for others. But this world needs more women like Reverend Linda, who are equipped and ready to become the curators of history. I heard someone of our, oh, and I want to also say how that was so wonderful to hear the excerpts from the book Crowns. That was beautifully done. But as our sister stood before us, one of the stories mentioned that we are the curators of history, the wisdom holders. We are the shoulders to cry on, the sages and the griots of the community. We need women who are willing to be those storytellers. We offer advice and we are called to bear witness to the stories of faith and miracles, while we also encourage and remind younger sisters that they can do it. And that means they can do whatever that they put their minds to. We answer their questions and we illustrate their lives with examples of stories of women warriors who paved a way to the river's edge on our behalf. We remind them that it is in community that we flourish, and united that we succeed. We offer a safe place where there is security, there's no judgment, and where dreams are encouraged to take flight, to blossom, and to bear their fruit. So today, as we reflect upon Crowns, we do so purposefully and through the lens of history that ties us together through those stories that we just heard. And we celebrate this tradition of women who were willing to stand strong in the face of challenge in order to tell these stories as examples of the power and love of God. Last Sunday was Easter Sunday, and across this nation, people attended church services either out of their weekly routine or as CMEs. Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter attendees. Churches were packed across the city and across the nation with women and girls and old ladies and even uncooperative tweens and teens who donned beautifully and colorfully adorned crowns. Crowns that seemingly represent a fashion statement, but as we have learned, really represent so much more. Crowns are indicative of a time when women considered a hat to be an essential component of her daily wardrobe. During the early to mid 20th century, most women would not have felt completely dressed without the inclusion of some form of head cover, along with nylons, slips, girdles that morphed into Spanx, gloves, and high heels, all wardrobe staples that have just disappeared like the dinosaurs. They really have. And we don't even know why. Some people did it for religious reasons or fashion statements. But to cover your head was to be a crucial component of a complete wardrobe. And if I were to look at this audience today and poll you, I'm certain that each of us can conjure up in our memories a woman who stands out as that woman who wore that crown with pride and dignity and beauty. And she knew that to be dressed was important, because we were to give our best when we entered into the house of God. For African-American women, however, the wearing of hats or crowns was more of an exception than a rule, as many were relegated to the type of labor that not only discouraged hats, but more than likely prohibited them unless the hat or the head covering was a part of their uniform. African-American women have a history of being marginalized in this country. Whereas society dictated that to be a proper woman, a hat was to be a staple of one's wardrobe, the majority of black women, for a large part of the 20th century, were subjected to another set of unwritten rules and laws that demanded that their femininity and oftentimes their dignity remain on hold until Sundays, when they were free to express their own sense of style and self-worth within the context of their religious communities, and especially through the way that they dressed. It was on Sunday morning, that one day of the week, when African-American women went to church, that for a few short hours they assumed a place of regal importance, and a crown was a fitting representation of the place that they held in society. For African-American women, especially those in the South, the wearing of the crown became a statement of dignity, pride, and status. Crowns became an act of defiance and protest to the social norms of racism and segregation, as women donned elaborately decorated and skillfully crafted hats in spite of the hostile and oppressive culture that met them when they stepped outside of the doors of the church. Women who worked as field hands and domestics were able to maintain hope in hopeless situations as they looked forward to exchanging aprons and field clothes for Sunday go-to-meeting vests that included elaborate crowns that they did so deeply cherish. Memories of the indignities and hurts and backbreaking work that they had experienced the week before began to fade as weathered hands that cooked and scrubbed all week long donned and gently put upon their head the beauty of a crown. The same women who were invisible for 6 days of the week became royalty on Sunday mornings when the crown was worn. The same women who were nameless just the week before became queen mothers on Sundays as their dress reflected their rightful places of royalty in their communities. For church mothers, especially the elders, as they are often referred to in the black church, the crown signified a special place of elevated status and respect to be given to the women that wore them. And maybe because of 1 Corinthians 11:15, it states that women should cover their heads, or maybe it was just submission to God, African-American women took on the wearing of the crowns as something to be held in special reverence. Whatever the reason, religious observance, vanity, creativity, or pride, what became readily evident was that the crowns set the wearers apart in the church community. The crowns were symbolic of the pride and earned wisdom of the women who wore them. So these crowns, seriously considered and meticulously selected, and matched to perfection with coordinated outfits, including their shoes and gloves, were more than simple fashion. In many respects, these crowns took fashion to the next level. Even the procurement of hats required thinking and planning, because hats, depending on their cost, were significant investments, and they still are, with many times hats going well into the thousands of dollars, which blew my mind when I was looking up the cost of hats. And hat culture has its own set of rules. And you know about the book Crowns. It was Michael Cunningham and Craig Murberry, two men who put this book together in the year 2000. And they provided a glimpse into the world of women who wear crowns. They said, and they give advice, they say, don't wear a hat that's wider than your shoulders. Now, we've all seen that rule violated in church. Sit behind someone with a huge hat. Don't wear a hat that is darker than your shoes. If your hat has feathers, like this, make sure they're never bent or broken. Sequins don't look good in the daytime. Easter hats should be white, cream, or pastel, even if it's cold outside. For a look that is both elaborate and demure, try a chapel veil. It is obvious that the historical relevance is as varied and complex as the elaborate crowns themselves. And what is also clear clear is that the tradition is being lost on the younger generation of women who no longer have the burden of proving their dignity through the way that they dress. We are now a culture of comfort and ease where gym shoes and spandex has replaced high heels and pantyhose. No judgment, I'm not judging, I'm just observing. However, for any person that has ever spent any time in an African American church, which I do highly recommend, there is nothing more spectacular than seeing those church mothers coming there with the crowns. And while crowns are absolutely beautiful, and although sometimes oppressively large, to the point of comedy, it is the wearer of the crown who is significant. And this is my main point. While the crown may be the star of the show, the woman wearing the hat is the main supporting character. And no matter the level of adornment or sequins or feathers, sparkles, firecrackers, flowers, ruffles, or frills, the woman beneath the crown is who matters most. Because, as I have stated, we are called as women to be more than what can be seen. We are called to live out the true measure of who we are based on what we offer to others. At Morehouse College, inscribed upon the walls of the Dr. Martin Luther King Interdenominational Chapel, is a quote by theologian Howard Thurman. And he says that God places a crown above our heads. We will spend the rest of our lives growing tall enough to wear it. That is the true meaning of the crown. It rests above us as a symbol of all the potential that we have to become all that God has required of us. The crown represents all that has been poured into us, all the love from others, all the advice, all the sage wisdom. That is what the crown represents. It is a testimony to those who are willing to invest into us, to love us, and to provide the resources so that we can go on a little bit longer. And what I've come to know is that while the crown is the showcase, the true beauty in the process of growing tall enough to someday wear it is what we all are looking to attain. The unfolding of life, the development of faith, the humbling nature of mistakes, and the bitter sting of death are all the factors that create in us a true and meaningful beauty. The crowns you have witnessed may have been simple headscarves or baseball caps. They may have been straw sun hats or bonnets to protect us, or to protect the loving grandmother from the damaging rays of the sunshine. Crowns in your life may have been African head wraps or construction zone hard helmets worn by women out of necessity or courage to make a way for you. The crowns of glory in your lives may have been lace handkerchiefs or festive fascinators worn to celebrate both God and life. Just remember that the true essence of the crown cannot be found in the hat itself, but in the woman who wears it. It is the woman who dares to know herself well enough to hearken to the voice of God that always tells her to choose love and to choose courage above all else. It is the woman who is authentic and is willing to wait and listen to the voice of her genuine self. She is the woman who answers the calling of the Lord and who understands her value in the eyes of God. So, my sisters, I thank you for your attention and I thank you for your time. Now, be blessed in the Lord and go forth and do what you have been called to do. Know who you are and continue to be a blessing in the lives of others. May God bless you and keep you. Amen. Amen.